my husband's cell phone.
Good evening. Welcome to the North Penn School District's Board of School Directors 1,050th meeting? Is that what that says? 15th?
We're at the 50th.
May 10th, 2016 at 7:30. This is a special action meeting, and we're going to start this meeting with a Pledge of Allegiance led by Mr. D'Azio.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Ed. We're going to start with an announcement that the board did meet this evening in executive session, May 10th, 2016, from roughly 6 p.m. to 7:30, roughly 7:25 p.m., to discuss matters of personnel, potential litigations, and also negotiations. We're going to start with our recognition program and our proclamations tonight. So, Dr. Dietrich.
Thank you, Mr. President. We are pleased this evening to recognize members of the Bridle Path Montgomery Select Strings Ensemble. And with us this evening, in addition to the students, we have Ralph Jackson.
Can you hear me now? There we go. All right. And I'm really proud to be here to introduce these students. Actually, this is the 15th time that this group, the 15th year in a row that this group has been recognized by the school board. So thank you so much for recognizing the students for their achievements. This is a group of sixth graders. We have 30 students in our string orchestra. This is our top level school group that we have at the school. We have 30 students, and these are our sixth graders we have with us tonight. They were chosen by audition to perform at the Pennsylvania Music Teachers Conference in Hershey, Pennsylvania, which was in March. So they performed for our music educators, and they received a standing ovation for their performance. It was a very, very wonderful time. And I need to brag just a little bit more. This weekend, we just had a competition where they won first place and also the best overall orchestra trophy. But in addition to that, they had the highest score of the entire day. They had a 99.3, which was really incredible. So I'm very proud of these kids. Yes. So I'll introduce them to you. First, we have Simran Mehta. Sierra Heisey. Anthony Wang. Gianni Cacesi. Simon On. Dylan Scott. Katie McGuire. Caleb Yanagawa. Allison Wolf. Elizabeth Delgado. Anna Chen. Evelyn Thomas. Shreya Harakrishnan. Sarah Choi. Jada Beach. And Jamin Condicetti. They'll tell you what to do. You have to shake the superintendent's hand. That's the most important person.
All the central administrators and the full board.
so I'd like to come through so they can congratulate you.
Go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. Go ahead.
This school board meeting will be aired on Comcast channel, cable channel 28, and Verizon Fios 29 on the following dates: Wednesday, May 11th, 7:30 p.m., Thursday, May 12th, 12:30 and 7:30 p.m., Friday, May 13th, 12:30 and 7:30 p.m., and Monday, May 16th, 12:30 p.m.
You can actually catch their smiles as they're going that way. All right. It is our time, since this is a special action meeting. We're going to move forward with our agenda, so feel free to join your kids if you want to. Our agenda starts off with an audience of citizens. You're welcome. Thank you very much. Anybody wishing to speak to the board, feel free to step forward, state your name and address, and sign the audience of citizens logbook for us tonight. Okay. No, it's a hard act to follow. That's all. Okay. Well, let's move forward with our agenda. Let's move forward with the superintendent's report tonight.
Thank you, Mr. President. I do have one item to recommend this evening, and if we could get a motion and a second, and then we'll have some discussion before we vote, and that would be I do recommend approval of the adoption of the 2016-17 proposed final budget resolution in the amount of $245,483,483. And authorization to publish notice to adopt the final budget in accordance with the Pennsylvania School Code and Act per item BA2, A through AA.
Motion by Mr. O'Donnell, second by Mrs. Perkowski. Comments or questions to the issue?
We do have a presentation, if Mr. Scrocky could lead that.
Thank you, Dr. Dietrich. Good evening to the board and the community members that might be viewing this. It's my pleasure to present the second leg of our three-prong process for the budget approval. Tonight, I'm going to discuss the proposed final budget for the 2016-17 year. You might recall the board did approve the preliminary budget back in January, and we'll be requesting final budget adoption at the June action meeting. So back in January, we were dealing with a number of uncertainties in the budget. In fact, we developed that budget back in December. Lots of information was unknown at that point in time. So if we can rewind back to January of 2016, we were faced with an $8.3 million budget deficit that was presented at that point in time. And I did mention at that time that that would be the worst case scenario, that we built in some very conservative assumptions, and that the situation would continue to grow a little bit brighter through the coming months once we received additional information. So rewind now, or forewind, I guess, forward to May. What's the date today? May 8th, May 9th, something like that?
10th.
Okay, I was close. All right. So now we're down to a $3.5 million deficit in the budget, $3.5 million. So about a $5 million reduction in the shortfall from January based on lots of new information. So that certainly, the picture is certainly brighter than it was just a few months ago. So back in January, one of the things we indicated at the end of the presentation that we would go back and do a number of items before we got to this point tonight. That we would review individual budgets with district administrators. We would review every line item in the budget, both on the revenue and expenditure side. We would work with the Finance Committee to take a look at utilization of our PSERS rate stabilization fund. And then we would continue to refine the budget based on new information, in particular federal and state allocations and also developments with labor agreements. And in fact, since that time, we did have approval by the board of the teacher's contract, which had a major impact in the development of the budget process. So the budget deficit I mentioned is $3.525 million, meaning that expenses are higher than revenues. So we are spending more money than we're bringing in. So in working with the Finance Committee, we developed a couple scenarios to bridge the gap, so to speak, with that $3.5 million deficit. First off, we recommended to the Finance Committee that we use $2.348 million of our PSERS rate stabilization fund. Okay, that's money that's been reserved and assigned in fund balance by board action, and it has not been used in the past, but for the upcoming year, we are recommending utilization of $2.3 million. Also, like the current budget year, we do have $1 million in the budget for what's called budgetary reserve. It's a hedge in case of an unanticipated expense during the year. In previous years, we have not had to tap into that budgetary reserve. In some years, it was only a small amount. This year, it's virtually nothing. So when you factor the budgetary reserve and the stabilization fund into the equation, that leaves a remaining deficit of about $177,000. Now, it is May 10th. The final budget approval won't be until the June action meeting, so if additional information comes in between now and then, we'll continue to update the budget, and it's quite possible that remaining deficit of $177,000 actually goes away.
Steve, excuse me, is it worth mentioning the cash flow report, that right number?
It's probably a good point, yes, Mr. O'Donnell. In the current year, just for a point of reference, we had a budget deficit of about $2.5 million going into the current year, the 15-16 year. Based on our projections, where we're at now with our revenue collections and where expenses fall, we actually think we're going to end the year pretty much break even. So instead of having a $2.5 million deficit this year, we think we'll be at break even or possibly even better than that. So at the beginning of the year when we did the budget, we thought we might need to dip into fund balance to the tune of $2.5 million. The way it turns out, with only a month and a half remaining in the budget, good news is that we don't think we'll need to dip into the fund balance at all, and it's possible that we might actually be able to add to the fund balance this year. And we hope the same situation occurs next year. Again, we do budget conservatively, in particular on the revenue side. So it is possible that $3.5 million, aside from budgetary reserve and the stabilization fund, hopefully that deficit is actually smaller when we get to actual numbers at the end of next fiscal year. So to briefly summarize, we have a $245.5 million budget that we're presenting, which is a $10.3 million increase over the current year. It's about 4.4% on the expenditure side. We are recommending the Act 1 index increase of 2.4%, so the numbers I'm discussing tonight already have that figure baked into the analysis. So the deficit of $3.5 million is after applying the 2.4% Act 1 index. Just hypothetically, it would entail a 4.5% increase to balance the budget, where revenues would equal expenditures, which would be above the Act 1 index, which we are not recommending. Just to highlight the budget comparison between the 16-17 year and 15-16 year, revenues would increase by 4%, $9.4 million. Expenses would increase by 4.4%, $10.3 million. Again, that would leave us with a $3.5 million deficit. Want to highlight, out of the $10.5 million increase in expenditures, we can basically explain that increase in a mere 7 items in the budget. Our pension, PSERS, P-S-E-R-S, Pennsylvania School Employee Retirement System, the pension system, continues to be a large factor in North Penn's budget, as is the case for every school district in Pennsylvania. Our increase in expenditures in the upcoming year totals $6 million. Now, keep in mind, we do receive half of that back in the form of a subsidy from the Department of Education, so our net increase will be $3 million, still a staggering number in our budget. Also, with the recent contract approvals and so forth, our total salary increases equal $2.8 million. It's worthy of mention that compared to the preliminary budget, we now have all the retirements that have been submitted to the Human Resources Office reflected in this budget. As of last Friday, all the retirements that have been submitted are now reflected in the budget. Also, we mentioned previously, and we've had some presentation at the Finance Committee with the Digital Age Teaching and Learning Initiative, that $991,000 figure is for the first year of a three-year lease, and we are going to discuss the one-to-one initiative in a few moments. Also, one of the things that changed from January to now is the final number for our Montgomery Elementary School project, a new debt, year one debt for Montgomery Elementary School, $191,000. We were able to eliminate about $150,000 from the January budget because we did the bond issue in late January. We didn't have the information when we did the preliminary budget, so we were able to carve out about $150,000 due to the low interest rates we had on our bond auction. North Monco debt is increasing by $129,000, and the reason for that increase is simply there was a bond refinancing last year, and we were able to reap savings in interest payments in the current year, so now next year basically goes back up to where it was before. We had 1 year savings in interest expense. We do have band instrument replacement in the budget, $90,000, and our existing charter schools, we're projecting an increase over the current year budget of $304,000. Keep in mind, it's important to note, this does not reflect any new charter schools that may open in the North Penn School District. This is for the existing charter school enrollment and what we're projecting in terms of an increase for the upcoming year. Mr. O'Donnell?
Yeah, Steve, where do you get the numbers for the incremental increase in the charter schools? Do you poll them? Do you ask them how many they're adding?
Well, we anticipate, based on the enrollment right now, Mr. O'Donnell, we anticipate spending about $2 million this year in charter school expenses, which is actually going to be about $200,000 more than what we budgeted. So based on the increase in enrollment that we've seen this year.
So you extrapolated.
Correct.
Okay. If you don't mind, sometime, please send me a list of the $90,000. Mm-hmm. Please. Thanks. Mm-hmm.
On the charter schools, too, just for point of reference, right now we have about 126 students in charter schools, and the cost per student for a regular education student, the cost in North Penn is about $12,000. For a special ed student, it's about $29,000. Okay, so we are projecting about a $304,000 increase in the upcoming year. We do expect to spend roughly $2 million. So when you add up the items I just mentioned, that's about $10.5 million, which is just about the amount of the increase in total expenditures for the 16-17 budget. Now, for a point of reference and comparison, the Act 1 index, the revenue generated by a 2.4% tax increase in Act 1 represents about $3.9 million. So you can see it is the major increases in expenditures far outweigh what is generated by the base Act 1 index. Okay, we're going to move on a slightly different direction right now and talk about something related to the Montgomery Elementary School project. Not necessarily reflective of the general fund budget, but it does tie into the overall financing for the Montgomery Elementary School project. And that's a concept called Green Globe. So I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Schneider, who's going to do a few introductions, and we're going to discuss the parameters of this program.
Thank you, Mr. Shockey. Good evening. One of the discussions for this evening is the Green Globes concept, which is a sustainable award and a sustainable program. With us tonight is Mr. Don Bonnet from Bonnet Associates and Peter Medica to go over the cost, the benefits, and the process. So, Mr. Bonnet, Pete Medica will be presenting.
Good evening. So as Tom mentioned, we'll just walk you through the basics of Green Globes and what we've done on other projects in the district and talk a little bit about what we would do with Montgomery Elementary. So Green Globes is a program similar to LEED, which is a national program run to talk about efficiencies with buildings. Green Globes is run by the Green Building Initiative, and The state of Pennsylvania recognizes LEED and Green Globes as programs that promote efficiency and environmental consciousness in schools. They both factor into reimbursement through the PlanCon process. Both Inglewood Elementary and Hatfield Elementary went through the Green Globes process. Both schools were fortunate enough to achieve a high rating out of Green Globes. Green Globes has a what they call a four-globe rating system, four globes being the best, a single globe being the lower standpoint. Hatfield and Inglewood both achieved three globes out of four for that, so that's considered a high level of achievement for environmental consciousness and efficiency in buildings. Green Globes focuses on sustainability. They go through seven main categories with that assessment. There's energy, resource management, water consumption, indoor air quality, site conservation, emissions, and project management. So they do an assessment. We go through with them, filling out a detailed survey at the start of the project. And then as we finish construction, we bring their assessors out to the site. We have a meeting, question and answer session, and then tour them through the building so they can do verification. So they basically provided a third-party perspective on your projects to establish, you know, your level of success through sustainability. The overall concept is a two-piece element. One is the GBI, Green Building Initiative. They have fees of $12,445 as their package. That includes everything from their assessment paperwork to the final site visits with the assessor. And then Bonnet Associates would have our services, which would be $14,000 to handle, again, everything from the paperwork at the start, meetings with them at the end of the project, and then during the course of construction, pulling together the documents from the project to submit to them for assessment consideration.
I want to open it to questions, I guess, at this point. Anybody want to ask any questions of the Green Grove process? I'm assuming, and from my knowledge of the past, we've incorporated most of the Green Globe efforts, I guess that's the better way to say it, into our design, into the equipment we chose, whether it's a lighting unit or a heating unit or any kind of recirculators, anything like that, is all part of the design process for us.
That's correct.
I've approved it before in other schools. I think it's a great measure of our success in the area of LEED and energy. So anybody want to make a comment to it, please do.
Yeah, I've supported it before. I think it's a great check and balance. Not that you guys do bad work or anything. We know that to the contrary. But I really believe it shows how good the job has been done, both environmentally, efficiently, I mean, in every aspect, as you mentioned. And that's why I support it, because, you know, so many people can come up and say, oh, how do you really know that, you know, these people are doing a good job? And, you know, there's different ways of knowing, but I really think that Green Globes is something that really shows that it's being done properly and right. And I think it's a small price to pay for that, how could I say, that, you know, third party to evaluate it and to see that what our goals are being accomplished. And I don't know, I'm really proud of the buildings.
I'd like to add something to that.
What's that?
Because you and I have been around a long enough time to know how this came about. Mm-hmm. One of the early things we tried to do in the district is save money through energy and conservation. We had
absolutely
a very high rating in those areas. We've saved millions in energy efficiency. And we did it not because we hired the guys who came to us and said, if you spend $1 million, you can save $1 million and change all the, you know, lighting units out, do all those kinds of interesting things, where we decided, since we were renovating buildings, we're going to incorporate all those savings ideas. We picked up the Green Globes design concepts because that was the way to do it without having really to pay out that $1 million when we renovated buildings. And we incorporated all that into our designs, and that's what we asked the architect firm to do. I'm sure that you look at this sometimes and you say, well, we have to pay to get our rating, but the reality of it is we're paying to verify that we have
that's
done everything
that's a good
we're
way
supposed
of
to
it.
Do.
Yeah.
And again, I've been around when guys would sit in front of us and make a presentation and said, if you spend $1 million replacing all these light bulbs and all these light units, we'll save you $1 million.
Right. That's right.
And we just kind of said, well, can't we do that ourselves? Why do we got to hire you to do that? Especially with North Penn being a bigger district with a bigger workforce, with more experience and more professionalism than these guys are bringing to us.
Yeah.
That's how we ended up into the Green Globes concept idea.
Well, if I can just ask a question, just for clarification, and I do appreciate the good work that you do, and I've been here long enough to see a lot of buildings renovated, and I appreciate all that, but just so that I'm clear, the $14,000 is what the school district would be paying you to submit for this award.
Yes.
Right? And then the $12,000 is what fee? What's the other $12,000 for?
That's for Green Building Initiative. That's the organization that actually runs through the certification.
Okay. So then what's the 14? So the $14,000 is?
That's the inspectors.
The $14,000 is our services to the district to
submit. Get yourself an award.
So we're paying? Process it for the district.
Okay. All right. So, and I understand, so for $26,000, you get a Green Globe Initiative Award and the recognition from the community and other architects, correct?
Yes. Okay. We and the school district.
The school district's wow.
Hey,
yeah.
Hey, just out of curiosity, do we know how many schools or school districts, out of the 500 school districts, how many school districts or schools participate in the Green Globes?
School districts, I can't say. I know nationwide there's been 38 elementary schools that have gone through and achieved Green Globes.
I'm sorry, you said 38?
38 schools have achieved Green
out
Globes.
Out of the country?
Throughout the country, yes.
So we're up there. Jeez.
38 have applied, Pete? Is that what I'm hearing?
No, 38 have been awarded.
We have had national recognition for energy savings, where we've sent our superintendent to Washington and won awards multiple years because of these efforts. That's what we're trying to prove. That's what we want to have the rating for. Plus, we can get money back in PlanCon if it comes through.
Yeah.
I think it's well, we don't know that until we actually submit all the paperwork from these people.
Yeah, that's another
That is thing. Not something we take lightly, because you're talking about a district that's won national level awards for energy efficiency and savings.
I understand.
This is part of that initiative. I know you may not have been here when we spent this kind of money, but believe it or not, we've seen lots of presentations on how to save money.
Goodness.
And we've incorporated that in our designs through our architect.
That's true.
And I'm not afraid to spend $28,000 to verify that and to go after the additional savings.
That's right.
So to Mr. Sierpinski's point, what additional savings will we get by moving forward with the application compared to the project plans that you've submitted to us that we've approved already?
Right. As Mr. Sierpinski has already said, the design is already going to achieve the savings. This is basically a verification and acknowledgement of what you're doing. So you could put Green Globes aside and still proceed and achieve the energy savings out of the project.
So we can put Green Globes aside. We can forego spending $26,445 and still achieve the same level of energy savings that we would if we went through the process and paid $26,000.
Yes. Yeah, we're not changing our design.
So you could say that to anything. I mean, with all the awards we give to different people and so forth, you could say, well, why are we paying money for this? You could use that same argument, what you're saying, to stop everything we do in giving people awards or whatever in regards to performance. Because why should we give them performance? We know what they can do because of test scores or whatever. I'm just saying, the whole logic behind this is verification. And also, it verifies that, you know, what we're doing
It's
a good thing. This isn't a bad thing, folks.
When we submit the PlanCon documents for Green Globes, what kind of a reimbursement factor are we talking about?
We're actually waiting for confirmation of the final number from PFM, but it looks like those costs that you get in reimbursement will approximate the cost you're putting in to go through the Green Globes process.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I'm all for spending money to achieve a greater amount of money in savings. I'm just not sure I see the connection right now about the savings that this $26,000 expenditure is going to produce for us. In fact, everything I've heard leads me to believe that we're not going to get any additional savings by spending $26,000. And
it's not going to cost us anything more either. You heard that tonight, too.
Several members of the board here don't think $26,000 is a lot. And in a $245 million budget.
It's going to be a verification, what John says, that when they incorporated the design, they incorporated the Green Grove's concepts. So that's to prove that they're in our design. So Hatfield, when they chose all the equipment, all the upgrades, we got three awards for that. That proves to me that Don and Pete are doing their job.
Yeah, because people
that's
have
a reinforcement. They're doing their job.
People have questioned throughout the years. How do we know that this is being done accordingly?
We've had audits, John. We've had energy audits. People come in and tell us we save millions of dollars if we implement some of those ideas.
Right. That's a good thing. I just think it's a great thing to do this. I really do.
Is this process evolutionary? Like over time, there's different items or recommendations of the design that Green Globes says needs to be done in order to achieve the award.
As you go through the Q&A period, you'll submit your first package to them. They'll respond asking for additional documentation. They do eventually provide recommendations on certain things at the end of the project to suggest that you look at for your next project.
So it could be improved over time, we're saying.
Definitely.
Okay, then
yeah, there's
with this
things,
school, there's even more savings that could be had.
As far as energy efficiency?
Yes.
Yeah, products and systems are always getting more efficient, so we're always looking to maximize that. At the end of Inglewood, they had a checklist of things to think about for the next project.
Right, okay. So there is savings increases, and that's where the savings comes in.
I mean, really, that's where the savings come in. If you want to say a savings, the next time you do a school,
right.
You can say, okay, we
the
missed these points here.
Got.
Right. I think that's...
Yep.
Okay,
that's
you bring great. To the table.
Absolutely.
And, to put it in perspective, Vince said it a little while ago. For Montgomery, $20 million project to spend $26,000? Come on. I mean, that's the verification what you guys do. So when we hire the subs, or the GC and the subs, that they're incorporating the Green Globe designs in your specs. So they do what we want. So we know we're getting the best energy efficient schools. And Tom's on top of that. Yeah, people should realize too, what you don't know, when we brought Tom in from Council Rock, we stole him away from over there. I think the first couple of years and all the energy we got, I went down Washington twice for the awards we got. And I think, Tom, what did you save us the first couple of years?
Frank, the bottom line is that Green Globes has led us to a way to save even more taxpayer money in the long run. And what people are complaining about now is we have to pay for that knowledge and for future knowledge and to use the future knowledge. This is an acknowledgement and a verification that we've done those things to save even more money for everyone. In the long run, we've saved millions in energy every year.
But we don't have to apply for an award that we can hang on the wall somewhere that says, good job, in order to figure out what we need to do to save money. It's just not the way it works.
An efficient district either.
Yeah.
Ask some taxpayers don't think you charge you too much.
That's right.
Good evening. Just wanted to add a couple points. The state actually encourages you to do these by virtue of the fact that you've discussed this already, of granting additional reimbursement as a result of accomplishing at least two globes. You have achieved three.
Three. Right.
And another point to stress, this is not just design, it's management as well. Your Mr. Snyder and your staff here, they manage the buildings in a certain concept of energy consumption that creates energy efficiency. That goes into the program as well as the design that we prepare. Back to the point of, yes, we have over the years learned to design to that standard. Whether you choose to go in this direction by trying to achieve a Green Globes accreditation or not, you're going to get the same energy benefit. I think that was well covered this evening. But the fact that the state encourages this, and we can't say that they're going to cover 100% of the cost. We think it's going to come darn close. We'll have a better estimation of that when your financial advisors report back. But this could be a cost-neutral investment by the school district. But as was discussed, it does, in fact, give independent accreditation and certification of the fact that you do meet the environmentally sensitive concept, ecologically sensitive and energy efficient concept of your buildings. So it's in that context that the state encourages by virtue of increasing the reimbursement.
So if I may, Mr. President, what I'm thinking I'm hearing here is that there is some division of thought on this, but I think what we're going to do is we're going to move the presentation along regarding the budget, and we're going to put this on next week's agenda in terms of a motion regarding Green Globes, and then we'll have a discussion and a vote at that juncture.
That's fine.
Why don't we do that?
Carolyn would like to say something. I'd like to
I just want to say, I look at it like, why do you want a triple E house? If you have an all-electric house, why do you want one that's triple E? Because it's going to save you money down the line. And I look at this as the same thing. For our district, you know, statewide, nationwide, we are doing the very best we can do for the environment. And that's just how I look at it.
I appreciate that comment because I was one of those people, along with Frank and John, who when we go to those school construction summits and the state people are there making the presentation saying this is something you should consider, and there are a lot of school districts that don't look that forward. They just don't go out and look at it like that. And they look at it as an investment in it. And I'll be honest with you, to us, we were looking at a district spending, you know, tens of millions of dollars on energy, and we were looking for ways to save money, and this was a definite way to do it for us. And it was a huge savings to the taxpayers over the long run. So I'm more than happy to bring it forward for further discussion
we'll
at the next meeting.
Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate
Thanks for
that
derailing
very much.
Our budget
Thank
discussions.
You. Thank you.
Let's get back to the budget.
Yeah. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Okay, thank you for that presentation. We're going to move on now back to the general fund budget. One of the items I mentioned earlier in terms of a digital initiative with respect to a lease amount that we have in for the upcoming year is a one-to-one initiative. And I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Dietrich for some introductory remarks.
Thank you, Steve. This evening, we do have Dr. Landis here, our Director of Technology, and Dr. Landis and I will be leading this portion of the discussion regarding the budget. As you'll recall, we have had two community forums. We also had a parent focus group that we brought together. I've also been talking to students about expanding the number of devices available to students, specifically Chromebooks, is what we're looking at for grades 6 through 9 for this coming year, and also making the necessary infrastructure changes so that we can have the necessary coverage and density to be able to have students online while they're in school to work with those Chromebooks. And then very importantly, what we're talking about is having those Chromebooks available to students to take home in the evening on the weekend. And we did, in those community forums, ask for feedback from our community members. What we're looking at here is an insurance cost reimbursement of $25. So if we purchase that insurance, then the student will be able to take the laptop home each evening and on the weekend, and the cost would be at $25, and they could reimburse the district for that. Also, we were looking at the internet availability in the homes to see if there are any families that don't have internet at home, how many would there be? And we've surveyed our students in grades 5, 6, 7, and 8, being that they'll be next year's 6, 7, 8, and 9th graders. And of those 4,000 students approximately that we surveyed, it looks like we have about 90 that would have the need to have internet at home that don't have it now. So we did speak with our Educational Foundation, and I'm really pleased to report that our Education Foundation is interested in sponsoring these families in need. They're interested in doing a campaign to generate money, and if in the event that for some reason they wouldn't be able to raise the necessary dollars to cover the cost of putting an internet-capable box in each home, that they would have the funds on reserve that they could draw upon. But they're very interested in sponsoring and meet this need in the community. That box is $140, and it does provide then the opportunity for the family to access the internet. We would have to pay for the data. But that came out of a discussion we had with the Education Foundation, so I'm pleased to report that. And we noticed some significant interest when we had the community groups together and we did those community forums and families saying they would help to help sponsor a family who has need. And we also put the question of lease-to-own in front of our community. There wasn't a lot of support or interest in the lease-to-own concept, and at this juncture I'm thinking it's probably not worth pursuing. And then finally, we did ask some more questions regarding the pace of implementation and you know, the other kinds of things that we should be thinking about, get some feedback from our community on that. But generally, we have very strong support to continue to move the initiative forward. And we're going to have Kristen come forward now, and she'll be able to talk a little bit more about two important components of it, namely the infrastructure, which is very, very important, and the upgrades that we're planning to do, and what this lease would cover, what's in the budget regarding infrastructure, and then finally those additional devices and the ideas we have regarding those. So Dr. Landis?
Great, thank you very much. My intern, Lauren, is going to be passing around two handouts for you. One will look familiar to the board members who are at the Finance Committee meeting. This is a bit of a streamlined version as we've worked through the plan to take a look at what are we projecting our costs to be as we move into the one-to-one, next year being the first year, and then moving beyond that so that people have an idea of the big picture. As Dr. Dietrich said, the two really critical components to this are the infrastructure and the devices. And I would say the infrastructure first, and then the devices. The infrastructure actually has three pieces to it. So if you're looking at the spreadsheet there where it has infrastructure costs for 16-17, you can see the initial purchase cost there is a little bit over $1 million. And that includes wiring for all three of our middle schools and our high school, the wireless access points, which if you look in this room here, you can see there's one here. So there's wiring behind that that has to be done for every single classroom, an access point installed in every classroom. And then in the back end, we have switches that are called PoE switches, so power over Ethernet. That's how those devices are actually powered. So those switches also have to be replaced. So those are the three components of that infrastructure cost that are critical. If we don't have those pieces, then it doesn't make sense to buy the devices. So luckily, a lot of that piece, we will also see some reimbursement for E-rate funding, as we did with the elementary infrastructure project as well. So our plan is to begin with middle schools with that infrastructure and then move into high school. High school's a very, very large project. There are 12 wiring closets, lots of electronics that have to be moved in and out of that project. So as we've been talking with our parents, you know, we did have some parents saying, well, what about high school? Why don't we start there? It's just really not possible for us to get all of that done this summer and be ready at the high school. So that's why we proposed to move it to the 6-9. So then the second piece is the Chromebooks, and we are proposing 6-9 because currently we have some of our one-to-one implementations at elementary. We have fourth grade and sixth grade having mini laptops. So there's a gap there in fifth grade where they don't have a one-to-one. So the proposal, after talking with teachers and administrators and really looking at how do we best utilize the resources we have and also move this initiative forward, we felt it was best to take those laptops that are in sixth grade, they'll be moved to fifth, because we don't really want fourth graders who are already in a one-to-one environment moving to an environment where they may have to share carts, they may not have access to technology. So moving that forward, supporting those fifth grade students, and then starting the Chromebook initiative in sixth grade. And that is commonly what other school districts do. Many districts have sixth grade in their middle school. You know, while we don't have that, it doesn't seem to be a barrier for us to be able to begin that in sixth grade as well. So those are the really critical components, the infrastructure, and then also those devices. Are there questions about
that? Just a quick question. It's kind of a little off here, but you're going to get a large number of computers. How are you going to receive them? The reason why you ask, and I don't want to bring up old stuff, but years ago over at Oak Park when we were doing a renovation, somehow a pallet was dropped, of laptops were dropped off, and the next day quite a few were missing. So I'm just asking you, when...
By the way, we recovered
you know. Remember that?
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, we got about
it. It went in, they didn't cover it up, and police got involved, and they got most of them back. But with the security of when these are received, are they coming here? Are they going... How do you plan to distribute, like they're going to come in, your people are going to work on them? Where are these computers going to... How are you going to get them?
So the company that we're working with right now is going to assist us in that process, where we're going to provide them with class lists by year of graduation for the classes that we'd be referring to. They're going to actually prepare everything ahead of time for us,
okay,
shrink wrap it, deliver it to us in skids, probably at the high school. That's typically where we receive our equipment. And then from there, we'll move it to the buildings for distribution.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
we're buying a significant amount of equipment, and we plan to. Are we buying through the state contract for this kind of stuff, or
yes.
is this a bid process? State contract, direct?
State contract, yes.
Okay. How are you dealing with the issues of affordability for some families? I mean, technology fees are common. I know every school I've ever been to, they always charge me technology fees. But is some of our fee collection estimates, are they based on things like how we do like free and reduced lunch for families? And is that part of our thought process, or are you just assuming $25
right.
for everybody?
That's a great question, Mr. Shapinski. We had a lot of discussion about this with our parent focus groups and then also with our community forum. At this point in time, we're saying that it would be a $25 fee and that it would be the expectation everybody would pay that fee. But clearly, if there is a family that is in need and says they cannot afford this, they should come forward and we'll make sure that we can take care of that. The Educational Foundation is very interested in helping us close the digital divide and doesn't want there to be any kind of a an issue with a family that simply cannot afford it. But the feedback we got was with that the $25 figure, the families would be expected to pay that, and simply if they can't, it would not be an automatic all free and reduced lunch don't have to pay or something like that at the cost of $25.
I just asked because I wanted to know how you've calculated some of that information. I would assume that it's going to be an issue. I mean, some of the families that I've seen in some of the schools, as I've gone to the elementary school, some of these families, $25 is a lot of money to them. So the question becomes, how do we deal with that as an issue, as a district? Plus, you can't give it to some and not others.
Right.
And that's a secondary follow-up problem. And I know that the technology issue has impacted everyone. I know that it's impacted HR. With social media issues and how the EEOC now is sending out warnings to people who use social media as a recruitment tool because it affects economically disadvantaged people and you're not being fair to everybody again. So it's a big deal, and we should come up with some policies and ways to deal with this and have a game plan to deal with that issue because it's going to be in our face in seconds as soon as you start to try to distribute this stuff. So whatever you thought about, I'd love to see how you're going to deal with that.
Sure, absolutely. So we are beginning to have conversations with all of our administrators about what policies and procedures need to be revised and so that we can make sure our kids are safe online. We have a digital citizenship piece that we are looking at for all students to have an opportunity to go through a process or a class or something like that. We haven't totally fleshed it out yet, so that they will be receiving a lot of education on that. We had the opportunity this past week to visit a school. Actually, today we visited one. I have a great clip for you at the end that I want to share. But and another school, and every school we talked to said that's really critical and that they work with all of their teachers and train them on how to help their kids be safe digital citizens online. So our goal is to not only do that for students, but also to help parents to understand how their kids can be safe online. All of our devices would be going home filtered, which I think we got a lot of positive feedback from the community forum with that as well. So they wouldn't be streaming Netflix at home on their devices. If that's something parents want, they would have to use a personal device for that. Our school device would have the same access to technology that they have here at school.
Okay. Any other questions for her before we move forward?
Have we been getting any input from our staff as to whether they're excited about this or embracing the idea?
They are excited. Actually, I have a group called the Digital Age Learning and Work Collaborative, and we meet as we need to at least quarterly throughout the year. We just met recently, and they are really hoping we can say we're absolutely doing this so they can get started planning. The second document that I had passed out to you just as a reference piece references how we are looking at the professional development because we recognize that that's critical and ongoing. So we have a number of pieces that we're working on, two models that work in tandem. And I don't need to spend a lot of time, but if people have questions, I can certainly go into detail. But the TPAC model helps us to take a look at our experts in the classroom have content knowledge. Our coaches, our literacy coaches, our e-learning coach have the pedagogy, technological knowledge. And we have, thanks to the board's support, some reorganization going on in my department where we'll have a role called the technology support specialist who will also be able to provide that support to teachers in the classroom with the skill training, working with our coaches, understanding the pedagogy, and so providing that in-building support that we need for teachers so they can feel comfortable moving this forward.
Is this the whole agenda for tonight?
It's a part of the budget.
One other question, Dr. Landis, a question that gets posed to me many times when I talk about this initiative. Will there be a way for our teachers to monitor what kids are doing while they're in the classroom within Google Classroom to make sure the kids are roughly staying on track and that they're not on, you know, different tasks or maybe pulling up an app and playing a game when they should be doing something else?
What? Kids playing games on technology?
We are looking at a teacher dashboard tool. There are a number that are available with the Google Classroom so that we can leverage that for teachers. We haven't identified anything right now, but we do want to make sure that teachers are feeling supported as they're implementing technology.
I know from my own experience in using technology as an instructional technology specialist, I have all kinds of management software to lock kids out of the internet, shut them down, freeze their screens. And I have a big monitor just sit there, and I can even sign on and play their game. Take it over. I do it all the time, crash them. It's a very difficult situation because you're right. When they're done their project and you got 25 students in a classroom and five are done earlier than the others, what do you think is going to happen? They're bound to be, busy doing something else. And if it is an issue, I think Mr. Diaz raises a good point. You need to make sure that's worked out too, because teachers are going to know, or at least need to know how to deal with that.
Absolutely.
So we have 970,000 plus here of lease costs that we have in this budget, in this evening's preliminary final budget. So we're going to proceed now with this. And if you have any additional questions between now and the adoption of the final budget, we can certainly entertain those. Oh, we do have a quick, you want to show this clip? Okay.
It's 45 seconds, if I may. I need to share with you. So we were at John Adams Middle School today in Edison, New Jersey. There was a team of us who went to learn about their implementation. They're in their first year of Chromebooks in their middle school, doing great things. And in terms of the classroom, we were in a couple classrooms where students were like, wait, I'm not ready to go yet. I'm still working. So it was really awesome. And so,
So our school, as you know, we experienced the academic satisfaction of each individual having a Chromebook. It's my staunch belief that Chromebooks are vital for our learning, and it really engages all the students and motivates them to learn.
Thank you.
In addition to what Jeffrey says, we can definitely see that over the course of the past few months, students have become so interested in learning, have gained that satisfaction of gaining knowledge once again, something that we've seen disappearing throughout our educational system. And with the introduction of Chromebooks, we can ensure that students have a lifelong love of learning from now until they graduate college.
Thank you.
And I just have to share, that student on the left, so I asked him if he would speak to me as if, you know, I might have the opportunity to share this with my board tonight. How could we convince them that this was a great thing to do for teaching and learning? And he said, I wonder if my parents would drive me there so I could come talk to them in person. So he was so thrilled. I emailed the principal and said we might be able to play this clip tonight. He was thrilled. So, thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Dr. Dietrich, I have one question. The 900,000 that's budgeted, does that take into consideration the $25 per person fee?
Yeah, we have a couple different portions in the budget. We have the lease cost, which is in the budget, and then we also have the discussion is the computer insurance reimbursement figure, where to put that, if we should put that, you know, in revenue adjustment, you know, or if we should put that somewhere else. We want to first see where the board stood in the issue of that. So, Steve, I don't think you have that in right now, do you?
No, the $25 fee, the insurance fee, is not in the budget right now. So we did have some discussion even earlier today, and we're probably going to end up putting it in the budget as a miscellaneous revenue. Based on the warranty coverage that we have, we'll probably consider it just as an annual miscellaneous revenue.
So we had a lot of discussion and with the parents about it. There was a belief that there was some additional buy-in into the importance of taking care of the laptop if there, you know, was a little, you know, fee being paid or a reimbursement for the insurance, that sort of a thing. The fact of the matter, of course, is that we don't have to have that. It changes by about 100,000. That's what we're saying for 4,000 students at $25. So we just wanted to kind of get some more feedback from the board about that. If the decision is to move forward with that $25, then we can put it in as a miscellaneous revenue item. If the board is not inclined to do that, then you know, we would not include that. And that decision really does need to be made between now and the final budget. So that would be in June.
Okay, moving on with the remainder of the presentation, this chart here, this pie chart, is a breakdown of our spending by what's called an object. It's a breakdown in accounting classification, but I want to highlight, when you factor in salary, benefits, and our debt service, it really represents close to 90% of our total budget. And once contracts are finalized, one could argue that these are fixed costs. They are fixed obligations once contracts are in place. So the lion's share of the spending really comes from those three areas. Want to review the Act 1 index quickly. Again, the Act 1 index for 2016-17 is 2.4%. It ticked up 5/10 of a percent this past year. The projections for the next couple years are to hover somewhere around 2.5 to 2.7%. I think are the projections for about the next 3 to 4 years. The Act 1 index is a lagging index, meaning that when there's economic recovery, it tends to take maybe 2 to 3 years before it shows up in the Act 1 index. And you can notice that 11-12 was a low point, and it's steadily increased since then. I mentioned earlier about the retirement rate, the pension rate. This chart shows, goes back to 2008-09, where the pension rate was for the school district at that point in time and where it's heading. You know, we were somewhere around 5% back in 2008-09. And if you go back even further, back to 2001, it was a mere 1% was our share as the employer. So back from 2001 forward to 2019-20, 1% all the way up to 34%. It's staggering. It's mind-blowing when you think about it. So the rate is projected to increase to a high of 34.2% in the 19-20 year and pretty much stay around the 32 to 34% for the next 30 years or so. So we're really not going to get much relief pending or absent any legislative initiatives to try to curtail the employer share of that expense. And that's something that was really at the forefront of our discussions with the Finance Committee, both with our long-term fiscal projections as well as the plan we were analyzing for use of that pension stabilization fund that we have. And again, we currently have $14.4 million in the PSERS rate stabilization fund. When you take a look at the retirement in another light as a percent of the total budget, you can see back to 2010-11, it was under 3% of our total budget for our share of pension obligation. And in the 16-17 year, we're going to be in the neighborhood of 15%. So it's increased fivefold in a mere 6 years. Fortunately, it will taper off now. We're getting near the peak. It won't increase much more. However, it's still at really obscene levels, quite honestly. Well, I would like to review the fund balance breakdown that we have through our last audit year. Our total fund balance is $36.6 million. I mentioned a couple minutes ago that our committed amount for pension obligation, our PSERS rate stabilization fund, is $14.4 million. We also have $2.7 million that's set aside and assigned for our self-insurance fund, and the remainder of $19.2 million is unassigned. And that represents 7.8% of next year's budget. And that number is important because there's an 8% cap in terms of unassigned fund balance relative to the next year budget. So we are under the 8% limit. So $36.6 million, to me, that represents prudent financial planning by the school board. Was helpful in enabling North Penn School District to weather the storm with the state budget that took about 9 months to get passed. North Penn School District did not have to worry about going out and borrowing money to meet payroll like some school districts did. So that's one of the reasons why it's very important to maintain a fund balance in case there's a crisis in funding, allows a school district to weather the storm.
Or if the state can't pass a budget.
I just want to reiterate regarding retirement that, again, to those who may be watching, that we have nothing to do with that and had nothing to do with that whole fiasco. I want to make that perfectly clear. And it's beyond our control. It's in the control of Harrisburg. And I wish we could do something about it, but I just want to make up, because some people don't realize that.
Excellent point, Mr. Schoen. We pay what we're told. That's the bottom line. We have no discretion in what we pay. We pay what we're told.
And that, if I may also, I just add to the discussion regarding the money that we've set aside for the pension increase. The Finance Committee has been working very diligently on modeling, making various assumptions, and determining how we might best use that, because as you use that, you also then have to wean off the use of that. So you take yourself up to use up to a certain amount, and then you back yourself back down again, so there's no fiscal cliff at the end of the use of the PSERS rate stabilization money. So I think right now the model we're looking at is using that over the course of about 5 years approximately.
Yep, 2021, 22 would be the last year that we would utilize the funds. So it is taking it out. In the 16-17 year would be the first year, and then it would extend out another 5 years beyond that to utilize the remaining portion of that fund. I mentioned earlier about being able to weather the storm absent state funding and a state budget. This is the second reason why we were able to weather that storm. The fact remains is that we rely heavily on local revenues for our revenues, our overall revenues. In fact, 78% come from local sources, primarily driven by the local real estate tax. Only 20% of our funding comes from the state. I think the statewide average is something like 2/3 come from local sources and 1/3 comes from the state. So we're much lower than the state average in terms of state funding. But again, we weren't heavily reliant on state funding. So when we were going months without any state funding and the fact that we had our fund balance to rely on, we were able to meet our obligations, both all of our vendors and our employees in terms of payroll.
So that's part of the state funding for North Penn. Send them a dollar, get back a nickel.
Yeah, we just want to make it clear that we don't want to be cut anymore in state funding. In fact, we do believe that the new basic education funding formula ought to be applied for future increases in state funding.
Correct. In fact, by applying the formula, we were able to derive an approximate $400,000 benefit by application of the formula with the $150 million new money that was added into the 2015-16 budget. Now, for next year, we are projecting an approximate $300,000 or $200,000 increase over what we have budgeted this year. So we have $9.5 million budgeted for the basic ed subsidy next year. And I need to let you know, that's at the low end of what the estimates are. That's with an additional $50 million added in statewide for basic ed funding. And hopefully that will be much higher than that. Hopefully it'll be $100 million and not $50 million. But we put in the low number in the budget, thinking that the only way we can go or only direction we can go is up. So again, that gets back to my point. When we present a deficit of $3.5 million, that's worst case scenario. We could have a situation where we could garner maybe an extra $300,000 or $400,000 in addition to what we have budgeted in the basic ed funding for next year. And in terms of basic ed subsidy, I'd like to point out what has happened to our subsidy relative to our overall revenues over the last couple of years. We've been quite challenged, and the basic ed subsidy obviously has not kept up with the rest of our revenues. We're down to less than 4% of our revenues now come from the basic ed subsidy. Back in 2005, 11 years ago, we were over 5%, 5.2%. So that has steadily declined over the years. Finally, I'd like to conclude with what the tax scenarios look like based on our recommendation of a 2.4% Act 1 index. We do have two counties in North Penn School District. There's a few parcels in Bucks County, and there's rebalancing with the millage rate that happens at the state level. But nonetheless, the average increase in Montgomery County for homestead properties would be $84, and in Bucks County, it would be $69. So I mentioned at the beginning that we are at the second step of the three-step process. Tonight, we're asking for your approval of the proposed final budget. We do need to have 30 days between the proposed final budget and final budget. We plan to advertise the final budget in the Thursday newspaper. It's posted online on the main webpage right now. We may make changes between now and the final budget. Any changes we make, we expect to be positive ones to further reduce the deficit I mentioned earlier. June 16th, then, would be our recommendation for the final budget approval, and that will be at the regular action meeting. At that point in time, we'll be notifying our tax collectors for preparation of the tax bills so they can be in the hands of property owners come July 1. And I believe we do have a motion on the floor. I'd be happy to entertain any questions relative to our recommendation.
Yeah. Any questions to the right? Any questions to the left? At this point,
I just want to note that, in the past, we've kind of been called out as, you know, boy crying wolf because, you know, we've been able to put that money away. And it's for because of what we did and how we approached the budget that we're able to do this and close the gap on the budget. Thank you.
You know, Josie, you're right. You know, years ago, we had the Innovation Celebration. That came up with a lot of good ideas. We're always, making changes here in IT to cut costs, even though, just so you know, for the one-on-one, I'm not telling you what we saw, but I was here for years ago for the e-summit when the Koreans were here, four, five years ago, and Diane knows. I've been pushing for this, and I saw the numbers in there. We all said, no. Put it back to what it was. So, I mean, we're pushing for this one-on-one. So I wish you success on that. But I think we've got so many good employees that are always coming up with good suggestions all the time. I think we're at the bare bones for staff, for supplies, for technology, for the that copier machine. The copiers we eliminated around here. I mean, we've saved so much money over the years that we've been a very cost-conscious school district, and that's put us in, as you say, the position we are, so that when the state had their problem, we didn't even think about borrowing. It's because we manage our money. We've got good business managers. I don't know about the past, but that's but we have good business managers. So I shouldn't say that. But anyway, I just resonate what Josie said. I mean, I think we've got a great, wonderful school district, and we got a good budget process. And I think we're there. I love the school district.
Well said, Frank. I'd like to thank the administration for working on the budget and refining it, Dr. Dietrich, Dr. Holden, everyone. Thank you. All right, we're going to have a motion and a second. We already do. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the final budget proposal?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Budget. You need a budget vote by voice?
Voice is fine. Voice is
accepted. All right. Call the roll.
You don't need one?
No, even better. All right, that's fine. It passes. Motion to adjourn this special action meeting? Adjourned. Do we have anything beyond this?
No.
So this turned